Christ have mercy on us. Lord have mercy on us. God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. If we understand your holy will, grant our prayer, O Lord. Do we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come? Grant our prayer, O Lord. That we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, O Lord. That we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, O Lord. May we end our days in your holy name, in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, O Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, that we might follow your holy will and gain eternal salvation. Amen. I welcome you here today on the last of our pre-Lenten Sundays, the season of transition. And next week when we come, well, not even next week, hopefully this week when you come back for Wednesday, the church will have more purple here, and we will be distributing ashes at 7:30 a.m. That was a request last year so that people could get it before going to school and going to work. If you come back to the evening mass at 7 p.m. instead, we will also have people with us from the Sunderland Congregational Church and the Waitley Congregational Church as well. And then the following Wednesday, we begin those ecumenical Lenten discussions. And also on Friday, we begin our Lenten devotions, and this Friday will be the Stations of the Cross. And I bring all of that up because this is that transitional Sunday, the last one, where we can start preparing ourselves mentally, spiritually, emotionally for all that is Lent. And so during Mass, think about whether you can make the time to do all of these extra devotions and activities that the Church lays out before us, because these aren't for my benefit. I love going to them. When I was an altar boy, going to Stations of the Cross, all the special masses, I think that's what led me to the altar. I loved it. But we have to really seriously think about these devotions, because they're going to fade from our practice because they are so poorly attended. So during Mass today, think about how you can maybe do a little bit extra during Lent. You know, Sharon and I, we try to go out every Friday to get a bite to eat. And I know it's that easy getting out of that habit. But you know, coming to church, at least for those seven Fridays when we remember Jesus' death on the cross, it's easy to kind of pass it off and just, you know, say I'll have fish instead of a steak when I go out. It's not the same as coming here and walking with Jesus to the stations. It's not the same as going on Wednesdays and hearing all these different pastors and the people that come together and how they take their faith to that next level and see what they get out of this whole message of a crucified God. So during this last Sunday of transition, the last Sunday when we can prepare ourselves for the beginning of Lent so that we hit it at full speed right off the bat, I'd ask you during Mass today to think about how we can be just a little bit different, and I'm even going to say a little bit better during Lent than we are, so that when we come to that Holy Week, and when we come to Easter, we are truly a changed people. So as we do gather today for this Mass, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience in preparation for communion.
I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you.
resolve to amend my mind, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, the Martyrs, and Faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
Amen.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice.
Amen.
And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power for all time, now, and forever.
The Lord be with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you care for us above all other creatures. From us are free us from all anxiety and turmoil of heart, who may seek first your kingdom and submit to your reigns. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
By the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah. But Zion said, "The Lord has forsaken me, my Lord has forgotten me." Can a mother forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. See, I have inscribed on the palms of my hands, your walls are continually before me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. For a brief moment I abandoned you, with great tenderness I will take you back. Because he is found by those who test him not. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. And Jesus said, "No one can serve two masters. He will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and mammon. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds in the sky. They do not sow nor reap, they gather nothing into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them all. Are you not more important than they are? Can any of you, by worrying, add a single moment to your lifespan? Why are you anxious about clothes? Learn from the way that the wild flowers grow. They do not work or spin, but I tell you that not even Solomon, all of his splendor, was clothed like any of these.
If God so clothes the grass of the field, which grows today and is thrown into the oven tomorrow, will he not much more provide for you, O you of little faith? So do not worry and say, what are we to eat, or what are we to drink, or what are we to wear? All of these things the pagans seek. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be given you besides. Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will take care of itself. Sufficient for today is its own trials. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Sharon, help me. Who was the big fancy person that she... Paris Hilton. So she had to bring Paris Hilton a dress, and not just a dress, but she calls it the look. And the look is everything that they wear on the runway, from, I guess, the dress to the shoes. I don't even know what all that stuff is. So anyway, she had to bring all of this to Paris Hilton, and she said probably that one look could pay for like a semester of college. So you think about how much stuff we put, you know, how much emphasis we place on what we wear, how much emphasis we put on how much money we can make, and all of these things. And Jesus says, don't sweat it. You know, God takes care of the birds of the air. You can do all the fancy things you want, but God will take care of you. Don't worry about it. You know, you can prepare for tomorrow, but God's going to be there too. And you know, we all prepare for tomorrow. But how many of us also prepare for tomorrow by trusting in God? The things that Jesus said to us today, they are not what we teach and what we believe in American society today. There's a disconnect between the gospel and between Christ. And Lent is a time where we have that chance to kind of reverse that, or at least bring them closer together, so that what we do here kind of reflects on what we do outside of here. So that Lent gives us a chance that all of those sounds that keep hitting our eardrums, well, maybe we can start hearing them. And Lent is only 3 days away. The message is simply not heard, though, by too many Christians. I think most everyone knows about Lent. Even supermarkets, they put cans of tuna fish on sale just as soon as Lent approaches. They're not doing that to help us fast. They're doing that because they want to make more money. Fast food restaurants, they're not doing it for health reasons. They start advertising their fish sandwiches instead of their hamburgers. And again, they're doing that for money. But Lent is out there. People know about it. But even if a person is not attuned to their faith, all of this Lent noise is noticeable. You can even on Ash Wednesday see a whole bunch of people with the ashes on their heads. And do you know they don't even have to go to church now? They can do a drive-by. You pull into the parking lot, somebody comes out, puts ashes on your head, and you drive out. What good does that do? Do it in your own yard if you want. Take some dirt and do it. What does that do for anybody? There's no message in pulling into a parking lot and getting dirt on your head. We're trying to make everything easy. Lent is noise, but we're not hearing what Lent is about. Lent is the preparation for, and it is the recounting of Jesus' last days. And I think we imagine that Holy Week, which begins with Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, with excited people waving palms. They think, here comes our Messiah King. He is the one that's going to set us free. He's the one who's going to be the one that we want him to be. And all of a sudden, when Jesus doesn't do that, there's a sudden shocking turn of events. And people start having to have their secrets about Jesus. They start plotting against Jesus. And Jesus has to go into seclusion and have his Last Supper. And at the Last Supper, even that closest band of followers, there's one, Judas, who will betray him. Then you go to the Garden of Gethsemane, and Jesus is there praying so passionately that it says that his sweat is turning to blood. He is scared to death. This is a very human Jesus. And then after the Garden of Gethsemane to rest, he's tortured all through the night. He's crucified in a horrible, horrible fashion. And then he dies and he's buried. Jesus does all of that on Holy Week. And do you think that we can understand the mystery of God accepting all of that by a drive-through ash or maybe having a tuna fish sandwich on a Friday? We have changed Lent so severely that it's only noise and we're not hearing it anymore. I think we can sometimes imagine that all of these sacred and solemn events at the end of Jesus' life, they are somehow separated from and even more holy than the rest of Jesus' life. But they're not. They can only be understood as the climax of the entire Jesus story. If we try and separate out the last days of Jesus' life and the rest of the days of Jesus' life, then it's going to be impossible to hear the message of Lent. Our crucified God is a powerful and a provocative image. It is so powerful and so provocative that non-Christians find that whole thought offensive and even blasphemous, that we would dare to say that we put God on the cross. Even in the early history of the church, there were all kinds of heresies. They said, how could God possibly do this? There were Christians fighting other Christians saying, it is impossible that God died on the cross. But Jesus, he did. And he is God. Remember this whole story of Christmas. Jesus is God. And God goes to the cross. And how can you possibly put all of that into a little box and never think that, you know, you just open it up on Easter and there comes Jesus popping out? This is work at faith. And Lent is the time for us to work. We need to try and come to grips with the why of Jesus dying. And then we can start separating out the noise of Lent. And then maybe we can start hearing the real message of Lent. You know, Jesus was not born to die. He died because he was so committed to his life. Lent is also not a season that's preoccupied with sin. You know, you might think that, because that's something that the church kind of really relies on, that we're all sinners. You got to come here to get away from all that sin. But Lent is not a message about sin. Lent is a message about a God who loves us so much that he loves us even more than he loves himself. It's not even so much about forgiveness as it is about assurance. And it all starts from the nature of God, not from us. We are all blessed with Lent because of the nature of God. So let's go back now to that reading from Deuteronomy. And Deuteronomy is the second prophet that is kind of combined all in that one book called the prophet Isaiah. And the prophet is writing about, you know, he's writing during the time of Israel's exile. They are absolutely devastated people. Most of the tribes of Israel have been assimilated into the surrounding nations, and they will never, ever appear again. And the few who remain, only two out of the 12 tribes, they are defeated and they are dispersed. They have lost their land, they've lost their temple, and some people are even beginning to think they've lost their God. And then Deutero-Isaiah, the prophet, he speaks in the name of the supposedly absent God. He repeats in the voice of God, and this God is repeating the voice of his people, the prayers that he hears, not even the prayers, the voices that he hears coming up to God. And God repeats those voices when he says, "The Lord has forsaken me, my Lord has forgotten me." God in heaven is hearing his people saying these things. And this is a version that ages refrain, that God doesn't care, that God isn't part of my life, that God doesn't matter one way or the other. That's why people don't come to church, because they don't think that God matters. And this is a sentiment that Lent is up against still today. And reducing Lent to sin and forgiveness is never going to draw people back to the faith who feel isolated from God, or even worse, who feel abandoned by God because things are just so bad. It's not going to bring them back to relationship with God. It's only going to be noise, and it's not going to be the message of Lent. But that's not where God is anyway. Sometimes you hear that the Old Testament God is characterized by anger and judgment, that he's a mean God, and that Jesus is a different kind of God. But then how do we reconcile that image with how God responds in today's reading? "Can a mother forget her child," says God, "or show no compassion for the child of her womb?" This is one of those biblical instances where the tenets of God is so compelling that the imagery switches from God the Father to God as mother. And even with this, the love of mother, God is not satisfied. "Even should a mother forget," says God, "I will never forget you." Now that should be enough. That should be enough that God's love is even greater than a mother's. But he's not convinced yet. He still has something else to say. But what could be even more persuasive than a mother's love? If it weren't part of the biblical text, it was an example that Father Randy came up with just to try to explain this, I'd be booted right out of here. But it is part of the sacred and inspired writ, and that imagery, I think, even though it's part of the Bible, it can be downright offensive. But even so, God reveals himself today as not father, as more than mother. He says, "I am your slave." We're far removed from slavery today. We don't bring up personal images of whippings and beatings. Mary's heading off to Washington with her school trip. Maybe they can go to the African American Museum. Maybe she'll have a better idea of the horrors of slavery after this week. We don't see people being bought and sold because of race or poverty or war. But slaves were owned human beings. They were branded like a rancher would brand a cow that he owned. And in the ancient world, a slave was branded on their hand with the name of the one who owned their body. And with that gruesome image, as part of their usual experience as a defeated people in a foreign land, God reveals through his prophet. He says to the prophet, for all of us to hear, "See, look here at the palms of my hands. I have written your name on the palms of my hands." Now what in the world does that mean? Think about that for a moment, that God Almighty says, on the palms of his hands, my name is written, your name is written. God is the slave. We are the owners. This is an upsetting image, but it is God's choice for how to convey the image of his commitment to each of us so that we can begin to understand the why of Jesus' promise. I had to go to a couple of funerals down in Westfield last Friday and then yesterday. They have a beautiful stained glass window of the resurrection. And as you're looking at that resurrection statue, the handprints, the nail print in Jesus' hand is so black. You can see it. That nail print in Jesus' hand after the cross, that is our name on God's hand. It's so much more than just sin and forgiveness. It's about a God who loves us even when we choose not to love him back. So who of us doesn't need that kind of support in our lives? Who of us doesn't want that kind of love? Who of us would stay away from this place because we don't want time for that kind of God where my name is written on the palm of his hands? During Lent, which begins with Ash Wednesday, just 3 days from now, will we be back here? Will we have time? When Lent begins on Friday and we walk with Jesus from the stations of the cross, will we be back here? Will we find the time? Or are we still going to go out to eat or to the movies or do whatever? Will we give a half an hour to the God whose name, my name, is written on his hands? We're given the opportunity every Lent to confront the complex emotions and revelations that are summed up in the cross of God. What kind of God is this? How do we react to his complete commitment to us? How does Jesus fit into our lives? Do we make time for Jesus? Do we take the time to tell somebody else about that kind of a love? Do we make the time and find the will to get past the noise so we can really take these next 40 days and hear the message of Lent? I hope and I pray that we can. And may this be our prayer as we today stand on the threshold of Lent and that unbelievable mystery that my name, that your name, is printed, branded, right there, burned into the eternal hand of the Almighty. May he have love and forgiveness for all of us if we dare to forget that kind of love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this, the last Sunday before Ash Wednesday, we do ask that our time that approaches quickly to 40 days, when we'll be able to appreciate better your time on the cross, your time of death, and also your upcoming resurrection, we ask, Lord, that we may take that challenge of Lent seriously. We also offer our prayers at this time in memory of Rose Girardi, who passed away on February 20th of 2014, offered by Bill and Teresa Girardi. We pray for the soul of Nancy Kahns, who passed away on February 8th from cancer. It's offered by the Durkee, the Brinsey, and Herzig families. We offer our prayers in memory of Fred Fair, beloved father, who passed away on February 20th of 1999, and Joe Poterala, the great neighbor of the Blodgett family, who died on February 19th of this year. Also, Les Thomas, a wonderful English teacher from right here in town, who passed away on February 25th of this year, and these are being offered by Teresa Belisle. We also continue to offer prayers for Liz Bridgman, battling cancer and raising three young girls on her own, Alex, a 16-year-old with lymphoma Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, is all offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer our prayers for Frank Sprosky, as offered by Brother Don, the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. We also pray for Bishop Thomas Gannat's health, and also for the strength of his wife, Catherine, who is caring for him, as offered by myself. We offer our prayers for following battling cancer, Meg Connors, by Ellen and Don Sprosky, Fathers Ray Freda and Maurice Lizell, as offered by myself. Richard Poe, as offered by the Poe and Foster families. 2-year-old Jack Soleil is offered by Mariana Foster. Are there any other prayers that you would like to offer at this time for the congregation? For all the prayers that we bring before you privately as well, Lord, and we ask you to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to be with those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, those who will be traveling on a school field trip down to Washington, and also be with those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. For these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant us, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen,
I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. You satisfy the desire of those who revere you. You hear their cry and you save them. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread. With the same faith and trust as the apostles and disciples of your Son, our Savior, when he said to them, I myself will be bread from them.
You.
lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. You give us the season of anticipation that takes us from the joy of your incarnation to the penitential mood of fasting and the contemplation of your passion. As we prepare to abstain from worldly trappings, open our hearts and our minds to a spirit of true contrition and of loving reverence for you. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept, to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide throughout the world, together with your priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. Imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love. Wholeheartedly this day, we unite this mirror with all of them, together the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread, and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those who he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me I would have in my company where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst." After these and other words of the archpriestly prayer and holy fervor, the Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed them,
broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you." In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who during life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
yeah.
Lord, from all ages, past, present, and future, and by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, and of your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days. Supported by the help of your mercy, may we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me depart from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master awakened in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Body. Thank you.
me.
I command you, be firm and steadfast. Do not fear nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord our God, when fears threaten us and doubts worry us, be our refuge and our strength. Grant us courage through your holy word and through this holy communion to follow your Son wherever he may lead us. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made. Yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, and his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willing, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.